الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالًا كثيرًا ونساءً، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. اعلموا عباد الله أن أحسن الكلام كلام الله تبارك وتعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم أما بعد، عباد الله، my dear brothers and sisters, when he first moved into the city, Al-Madinah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he started with the first and most crucial task, and that is building a community. Ten and a half years later, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was leaving this world, once again, the last thing that he did, he made sure that this community was okay. And that beautiful look in his face, salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi, was just the reward for the ummah that he was satisfied with that. In between those two moments, there was so much work that was done. SubhanAllah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the last day of his life, he was in his house. He was exhausted, was getting very tired, near death moment. But then he heard the sahaba doing their salah in jama'ah in the masjid. His house was attached to the masjid. His room was right there. The door leads to the masjid from there. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stood up and he walked towards the window that overlooked into the musalla area. And there he saw the sahaba praying behind Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. To that sight, he smiled. He smiled. Some of the sahaba who were near that window and they saw him, they thought he was recovering and he's coming out, so they almost left their salah. In the hadith, kadu an yuftanu, like they almost broke their salah and went to bring him out. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he pointed to them in his hand, "They remain where you are." And they stayed. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was never seen alive after that. But that smile was a very rewarding smile. That the 10 years of hard work in making the community to become who that community became afterwards was a great actually work. Now the sense of brotherhood was what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was working on. You see, the Western tradition, the Western culture of governing, actually prides itself in what they call the social contract. In that social contract, people between the government and the governed ones, there's this kind of understanding that we elect you, we select you, and then we put you responsible and accountable for taking care of the community, according, of course, to what we agree all on. That is the basic principle, and they pride themselves with that. Now, the Muslim system has an element even more than that, much deeper than that. And that's the element of brotherhood. It's not just about electing or selecting people to be leaders. It's about selecting and electing brothers to help us. And we help them as well. So that sense of brotherhood is so important, because we believe that sense of brotherhood, which goes again beyond the government and beyond the governing body of any community, it's a divine gift. That sense of brotherhood is a divine gift. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً. The believers are but brothers and sisters. So it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we all brothers. It's a gift from Allah azza wa jal. And subhanallah, it's a blessing from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. When people come to the masajid, you always see those, specifically non-Muslims, they come with different tradition and cultures. When they come, one of the things they notice, depends on how healthy the community is though, they sense that sense of brotherhood, especially in Ramadan. When everybody in the mood to be spiritual, when people, they share their food together, when they share moments together, subhanAllah, that sense of brotherhood is a blessing from Allah Azza wa Jal. People notice that. I remember one time, I invited a friend to come. Actually, he was a pastor in a church, in his own church. So he came visiting one day. So it was a time for salah as we were speaking. So I asked him to take a break and just go and pray and then come back again. So he asked if he could observe. I said, of course, absolutely. He came in. And subhanAllah, he sat there watching us as we were praying. And when we finished, Then when we came back again in the office, I could see in his face there is that sense of amazement. He goes, this is amazing. So what is it? He goes, your community. I said, what do you say? He goes, well, it seems that the people, to him, the most ironic sight is how people were diverse and they still line up next to each other. And after Salah, they're very, very casual with each other. Like that sense of formality is just like there. I said, because we're brothers. It's that what it is. That's what makes us so actually easy with each other, that sense of brotherhood. When you break the ice and you're always together in one community and you're all here for the same purpose, that's a sense of brotherhood. And you know what? It's not my work. That's not your personal work. That's not because you're brilliant. That's not because of your ideas and your opinions. It's not because you're the one who knows everything best for us and for yourself and for the community. No, Allah. It's a blessing from Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear in the Quran, in Surah Al Imran and Surah Al Anfal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَوْ أَنْفَقْتَ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مَا أَلَّفْتَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ أَلَّفَ بَيْنَهُمْ. Speaking of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that if you go and you spend the treasures of the earth, if you spend everything, all the riches of this world, in order to bring their hearts together, you won't be able to be successful. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ أَلَّفَ بَيْنَهُمْ. But it's He subhanahu wa ta'ala who brought their hearts together. And in Al Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and remember the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal, the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala He bestowed upon you when you once were enemies against each other. When you once enemies against each other, fighting each other, فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ. He brought your hearts together. He united your hearts together. فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا. And because of that favor that He bestowed upon you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, you became brothers. So that whole sense of being a community and brotherhood and sisterhood in one community, it's a blessing from Allah Azza wa Jal. Now you guys tell me, who's the one who hates that? It's the shaitan. He tries to seek every opportunity to sow a seed of differences and defiance and whatever you want to call it, to create fitna. That's the shaitan's job. The Prophet ﷺ made it clear to us. The Prophet ﷺ says in the hadith that إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ قَدْ يَأْسَ أَنْ يُعْبَدَ فِي أَرْضِكُمْ. هَذَا الشَّيْطَانَ. Shaitan became desperate to be worshipped in this earth. Like he had no hope to become God. He won't be able to be God in that sense. But he accepts one little thing from you. بِالتَّحْرِيشِ بَيْنَكُمْ. Like inciting hate and troubles and fitna amongst you. Like basically, these hearts will be divided. That's the job of the shaitan. Now, when we have that sense of true brotherhood towards one another, it usually comes with that strong feeling of passion and compassion towards one another. That sense of sacrifice, the sense of respect toward one another, the sense of trust for one another. Subhanallah, Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala, they displayed the best example to this. Remember when the Prophet ﷺ brought the Ansar and the Muhajirin as they arrived in Medina? In Medina, what did they do? He said to the Ansar, the locals of Medina, he says, here you go. Take one of these Muhajirin. Today we call them refugees. Take one of these Muhajirin under your shade, under your wing, and take care of them. He's your brother. SubhanAllah, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, I mean, they took it to the next level. So they came and they said, hey, listen, I have all these things, alhamdulillah, in this world. I would like to share this with you. Like Abdurrahman ibn Awf, he said, when his brother, the Ansari, came to him, he said, listen, I have all these lands, all these houses, all this money, all this business, and even his family. He goes, I want to share this with you. He goes, Barakallahu laka fi ahlika wa malik. You see, they were not required to do that. But they understood the meaning of brotherhood to the max. So he went, he said, listen, I would like to share everything with you. Abdurrahman ibn Auf didn't take advantage of this. He didn't take advantage of that. He could have done that. But what he did, he told him, Barakallahu laka fi ahlika wa malik. May Allah bless you, bless your wealth and your family. Show me where the market is. Like, I can take care of myself. Where's the market? He took him to the market. Abdurrahman ibn Auf was a brilliant, brilliant businessman. So in 1 week, he was walking the streets of Medina, and you can smell nice fragrance on him, and he looked very nice and tidy. And the Prophet was, mashallah, bakh in bakh, like, wow, mashallah, what is this? Where did this come from? He goes, tazawwajt, I got married. In 1 week, mashallah. He came muhajir, now he has all this money and wealth to have perfume and excess wealth to buy new clothes and so on. And the Prophet ﷺ made dua for him that may Allah bless him. He said to him that may Allah Azzawajal make your hand barakah. That as a result of that, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, they said, if he would sell you the desert, the sand of the desert, and he would convince it to be gold, he would do that. He was so clever, basically. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. The point we're making over here is that these Sahaba, radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they had this kind of trust, that this man, he's trusting this man with a stranger to him. A stranger to him, just came from out of nowhere. But just because the Prophet ﷺ said, take care of him, he put all that trust in this man. All that love, all that respect, all that, you know, subhanAllah, you name it. That's the passion and compassion to the cause and the principle and the bigger vision that the Prophet ﷺ was bringing to the community. See, in order for us to achieve that sense of brotherhood, the iman needs to be strong and taqwa needs to be strong. Why is that? Because Allah Azza wa Jal made these two conditions. To have a strong brotherhood, you have to have a strong iman and a strong piety and fear of Allah Azza wa Jal. When we lack them, we have weak iman or weak piety and consciences of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over worldly things, then we're not going to have strong brotherhoods. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, innama al-mu'minuna ikhwa. The true believers, they end up being ikhwa, brothers. Which means if there is no brotherhood, truly brotherhood among believers, there is something wrong with their degree of iman. Something wrong with their understanding of being believers and being faithful. Something is wrong there that needs to be corrected, needs to be fixed, needs to investigate, need to check yourself, check your heart, check your iman, check your ibadah and your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are you at that level that you'd be proud of it on the day of judgment? Do you think you had enough of that for you to see yourself spiritual in that sense, that you would come and you establish the sense of brotherhood and sisterhood in your community? The second thing is taqwa. See, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, al-akhillau yawma idhin ba'duhum li ba'din adu illa al-muttaqin. On the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, al-akhilla, buddies and friends. We call them today cliques. These buddies and friends and cliques, ba'duhum li ba'din adu, they're going to be on the day of judgment enemies towards one another. Like, it's your fault. You ruined me. You this, you that. The Prophet ﷺ says, illa al-muttaqin, except for the most righteous. Because they established their community, they established their gathering, they established their unions, they established their everything related to what they do together based on taqwa, conscience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we fear Allah azza wa jal, you know, in the public or in private. The thing is that shaitan is clever, and he will come in tons of ways in order to convince us otherwise. However, with all we say about brotherhood and sisterhood, that doesn't mean you cannot come and advise your brother. It doesn't mean you cannot differ with your brother. No, no one said that. It doesn't mean. But what it means is that when you do it based on love and respect towards one another. That's the meaning of being brothers together. That's the meaning of being a community. You see, Ibn Hazm rahimahullah ta'ala said, istabqaka man atabak. Which means, if someone wants to keep your brother and a friend, will advise you. If someone gives up on you, means they don't care about you. So it's okay. It's healthy to have this discussion. It's healthy to admonish each other. In the Arabic, we call it itab. I looked for English word for itab. I couldn't find anything close to that. They use the word reproach, and they use the word admonition, to admonish somebody. And subhanAllah, the word itab in the Arabic language, it's not admonishing or reproaching. No, it's more of a compassionate advice. That's what it means. Like, when I advise you, when I see something wrong, I would like from you to quit. When I see that you're doing something wrong, I want to stop you. I do it out of compassion. That's what it is. It comes from the heart. Because I care for you. And I care about you. And I care about everybody else. That is what we call itab. And it's okay. Itab is okay. And it's very natural. SubhanAllah, Raja ibn Haywa said, مَنْ لَمْ يُؤَخِي إِلَّا مَنْ لَا عَيْبَ فِيهِ. If you're going to only become friends and build this brotherhood Only with those who have no blemishes, no mistakes, then you find less friends to take around you. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَرْضَ مِنْ صَدِيقِهِ إِلَّا بِالْإِخْلَاصِ لَهُ دَامَ صَخَطُ. If you want to have your friends always to be sincere to you, then you're going to always be upset. Because they're human beings. وَمَنْ عَاتَبَ أَخْوَانَهُ عَلَى كُلِّ ذَنْبٍ كَثُرْ عَدُوهُ. But if you keep blaming and keep criticizing your friend for every single mistake and error, you will have so many enemies around you. You see, it's easy to make enemies, ya jama'ah. Wallah, it takes a skill to make friends and allies. It takes a skill to make friends and allies because making enemies is simple. It doesn't need a skill. But to have this kind of sense of brotherhood and sisterhood, that definitely needs and requires a skill. One of the examples of the best form of itab, subhanAllah, from the seer of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi came back from Hunayn, the battle of Hunayn after they conquered Mecca, and they went to fight against those who gathered just in the last throw to fight against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Hunayn. And the Sahaba, they were almost defeated militarily. Because of their number, they thought they were going to win. But subhanAllah, they were almost defeated. But then they won the battle eventually. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam afterwards, he distributed a great amount of wealth. A great amount of wealth, like you say, you could say like $1 million. Giving $1 million to four people each. Each of them got actually $1 million, you could say, in that sense, because they got 100 camel, equivalent to $1 million in our time. He gave it to some of the elderlies and some of the elite of Quraysh, whom they just were defeated in that moment. He gave each one of them $1 million. What happened? The Ansar, the majority, the Sahaba, who fought all these years, for 8 years, fighting with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now suddenly after they conquered Mecca, he came in and he's favoring, according to them, his own people. Like, look, hey, he's favoring these people. I mean, some of the Sahaba even, they said that, how come he's doing that when our sword still has blood from their blood on it? Like, how is that even possible? So they got very upset. And they start speaking, whispering here and there and so on. The Prophet was completely oblivious to this. He was unaware of that kind of, you know, talking in the background. And obviously, the Muhajirin were just a minority among them, the Ansar. But then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he heard about it, so he called Sa'd. He called Sa'd. When he called Sa'd ibn Ubadah, was the leader of the Ansar, and he asked him, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, what's going on? فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إن هذا الحي من الأنصار. These people from the Ansar, قد وجدوا عليك في أنفسهم. They having something in their hearts about you. لما صنعت في هذا الفيء. In regard to what you've done with the spoils of the war, you've given it to these people, يعني. And you've given them عطايا. You've given these people so much so that you can, like, what about them? قال فرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, immediately he asked the leader. He said to Sa'd, what about you? Ya Sa'd, what do you say about it? And imagine, this is Sa'd ibn Ubadah, jama'ah, one of the top leaders, the most righteous of the Sahaba, radiallahu ta'ala anhum wa ardahum. But in that moment, he was a human being too. So when the Prophet, he asked him, he said, what about you? What do you think about it? قال يا رسول الله ما أنا إلا من قومي. I'm one of my people. Like, what do you expect me? I'm kind of like feeling the same thing too. SubhanAllah, even the most righteous might have something in their heart. But the way they bring it up, that makes a big difference. قال فاجمع لي قومك في هذه الحظيرة. The Prophet ﷺ says, then gather all the Ansar, the people who have these issues with together, bring them here, let me talk to them privately. So when they came and they gathered, it became a historic moment in the history of Islam, how the Prophet ﷺ had this beautiful, beautiful interaction with the group of people when they had some disagreement. فقال يا معشر الأنصار مقالة بلغتني عنكم. I heard something from you, O معشر الأنصار. وَجِدَةٌ وَجَدْتُوهَا عَلَيَّ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. Something you have on your heart about me. So he was waiting for them. And then they didn't say a word. قَالَ أَلَمْ آتِكُمْ ضُلَّالًا فَهَدَاكُمُ اللَّهِ. He says, did you forget that you were going astray and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided you through me? وَعَالَةً فَأَغْنَاكُمُ اللَّهِ. You were poor and Allah made you rich because of me. وَأَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ. And you were enemies fighting each other and you became now brothers. قَالُوا بَلَى. Said, of course, Ya Rasulullah, we didn't forget that. And Allah wa Rasuluhu amannu wa afdal. that the favor is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger upon us. Now that's something the Prophet ﷺ brought up to them. They can get upset and angry because of that, right? And the Prophet ﷺ understood that. He validated their emotions and their feelings. قَالُوا بَلَا يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمَنُّ وَأَفْضَلُ قَالَ أَلَا تُجِيبُونِ يَا مَعْصَى. He said, okay then, answer me. You can answer back. قَالُوا بِمَا نُجِيبُكَ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. What are we going to say? When you are the messenger of Allah and the favor of Allah and the messenger is upon us. قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. So the Prophet now, he's validating their emotions. And he's like kind of repeating what could be going through their minds and their hearts of anxieties, agonies maybe, or grievances and so forth. قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. أَمَا وَاللَّهِ لَوْ شِئْتُمْ. If you want to say something, you will say it. وَلَصَدَقْتُمْ وَلَصَدِّقْتُمْ. Like you will tell the truth and we will believe you in it if you say it. أَتَيْتَنَا مُكَذَّبًا فَصَدَّقْنَا. You came and your own people, they didn't believe you, but we believed in you. وَمَخْذُولًا فَنَصَرْنَاكْ. You've been let down by your own people, but we supported you. وَطَرِيدًا فَآوَيْنَاكْ. You were like an outcast leaving Medina, and we gave you shelter and refuge in our city. وَعَائِلًا فَوَاسَيْنَاكْ. You didn't have anything in your hand. We gave you everything. We gave you everything, the wealth and the money and so on. He said to them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that. You see, he reminded, he said, you could say that to me. It's okay, and I will believe you because you did it. Like he validated what they've done. So whatever sacrifice that anyone does in a community, no one is going to deny that. But look what the Prophet told him. He says, أَوَجَدْتُمْ يَا مَعْشَرَ الْأَنصَارِ فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ عَلَى لَعَاعَةٍ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا تَأَلَّفْتُ بِهَا قَوْمًا لِيُسْلِمُوا وَوَكَلْتُكُمْ إِلَىٰ إِسْلَامِكُمْ. Like saying to them, like, this is it? We're coming to this right now? Yeah, you're finding yourself in your heart against me because I've given the dunya to people because I want them to come to Islam through this. When I trusted you with Islam in your heart, like I believe in you, that's why I didn't want to buy you. It's because I believed in you, I didn't want to give you the dunya. Because I know in your heart what is more valuable to you, I can give it to you for money. So the Prophet ﷺ told them that, أَلَا تَرْضَوْنَا مَعْشَرَ الْأَنصَارِ. O people of Ansar, don't you want the people to go home بِالشَّاتِ وَالْبَعِيرِ. They go with the goat and the cow and the camel with them. And you go to Medina with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like he said, listen, just the fact that we conquered Mecca, I'm not staying here. I'm going back with you. Like he's saying, I'm like Ansari right now. He said to them, قَالَ فَوَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ. I swear by the one whose soul is my soul is in his hand, subhanahu wa ta'ala. لولا الهجرة لكنت امرأة من الأنصار. If it wasn't for the hijra, that I just by default I came from Mecca to Medina, became a muhajir. If it wasn't for this, I would love to be an Ansari. Like I want to be one of you. ولو سلك الناس شعبا وسلك الأنصار شعبا لسلكت شعب الأنصار. Had the people go any path in this world and the Ansar go one path, I would go with the Ansar. That was a conciliation moment for all of them. And as we can see, in communities, differences happen. But it's a learning experience. But the way we handle it, it will make a big difference. And that is the community of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه إنه الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا ثم ما بعد. If I can ask you, brothers, please move forward, جزاكم الله خير, for any gaps, so we can have enough space for those who come, inshallah, to land the back. جزاكم الله خير. Just move forward. جزاكم الله خير. My dear brothers and sisters, now Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah رحمه الله تعالى, he mentioned an example of the brotherhood in a very beautiful way. He said, مثل الإخوة كمثل اليدين. The brothers, or brotherhood in this sense, he said, the example of brotherhood is the example of two hands. Basically, when there is some dirt in your hand, what do? You rub it. That friction makes it hot. But what's the result? It becomes clean. And that's exactly the sense of brotherhood. Sometimes we rub each other, we create friction, becomes a little bit hot, but the end result is, inshallah ta'ala, to make our hands clean. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said, the example of the brothers together, the example of the eye and the hand. So when the hand hurts, the eye shed tears. And when the eye shed tears, the hand wipes it off. It's the example of a community, the example of brothers and sisters together. And that is the example and the role model, alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, we've been experiencing this community for a very long time. And we would like to keep the spirit, bidnillahi tabaraka wa ta'ala. I know that now, as we move to the future of our community, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, specifically for the brothers who are registered members of the community here, that the vote is coming today, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, for a crucial moment for us in regard to the future of this building. And I want you to take the responsibility seriously, inshallah, azza wa jal, keep it in your mind and in your heart. It's about the community. It's not about me. It's not about anyone in particular. It's all about us. And like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, decides things by consulting with the community. This is our chance, inshallah ta'ala, to work it out together. Once again, it's a golden opportunity to show brotherhood and sisterhood in this community again, inshallah tabaraka wa. Remember that. Remember that. Brotherhood and keeping together, it's a blessing from Allah Azza. That's ni'mah. And wallahi, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had filled your heart with love and passion and compassion to brothers and your sisters, you have been blessed. And if your heart is so hard, you don't have that compassion to your brothers and to your sisters, then I don't know what to tell you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy on you. Allahumma alimna ma yanfa'na, wa anfa'na bima alamtana, innaka anta al-alimul hakim. Allahumma ati nufusana taqwaha, wa zakki anta khayru man zakkaha, anta waliyuha mawlaha. عباد الله إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وارض اللهم عن خلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر الصحابة أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وأقم الصلاة